My earnest gratitude to Professor N.K. Ganguly. He was kind enough to give me an opportunity to speak in this symposium where people are speaking mainly on probiotics and the intestinal microbiome, and I'm the one who is speaking on skin. So we work in NIBMG, National Institute of Biomedical Genomics. It is in Bengal, and we are 1.5 hours from this place. And I find no speaker on microbiome research speaking in this conference from Kolkata. So I take the privilege to represent this city. I'm primarily speaking on microbiome in skin health and disease. First, I would pay a tribute to Joshua Lederberg. He is the one who coined the term microbiome, and he needs no mention. And previously, when we started this work, I joined the NIBMG in 2014. So everything I'm showing is the 4 years' work. So we knew the human cells and the microbes. The microbes outnumber the human cells by huge number. 90% of our cells are microbial, etc., etc. But now we know it's not true. It's 50% of our cells are microbial. Then it's also interesting. And in NIBMG, we are working on GWAS, NGS of the humans. And we often do get intrigued to find out the missing heritability. And now it is the time when people believe that the missing heritability must be in our microbiome. And so now for GWAS study, we are doing MWAS studies, metagenome-wide association studies. So this particular publication intrigued me to study the healthy skin. This particular study had the gut microbiome of the Hadza hunter-gatherers, and this showed that the Hadza hunter-gatherer microbiome is not same like the Italians. In the Italians, you have more of the bifidobacteria, and you often take that as a probiotic. But in the gut microbiome of the Hadza, you have treponema. Treponema is a very dangerous bacteria considered to be present if in the Italian microbiome. So you know that the gut microbiome is not same for all. One probiotic cannot act on the other country. One reference microbiome cannot be taken for comparison to some microbiome alterations in other countries. So we thought that when we will study the skin, we sought to find out if we have some healthy skin microbiome from Asia or India. We found none. None of the studies at that time studied the Asian skin microbiome, although in the Human Microbiome Project, we had several of the European skin microbiome studies done. So why we study the skin? The skin is the largest organ of our body, and there are several examples that it's the first line of host defense. It combats all the bacteria that comes to our body. And it's also important for association with atopic dermatitis, psoriasis, and different kinds of skin diseases. And that's our study. We studied the facial skin microbiome of healthy female volunteers. And why female? We thought, since we are doing a handful of samples, because you often don't get money from DBT, DST to get healthy. So since an NGS is a very costly affair to do, since we are doing a handful of individuals, we would not make gender as a confounder. We would not make age as a confounder. So the age limit is also very strict. And what do we mean by healthy? By healthy, we mean that these individuals have not taken any antibiotic for the last 6 months. These individuals are not pregnant in the last 1 year. They applied no skincare product on their face for the last 14 days. And they used a soap without any antibacterial active in it for the last 14 days time. So these are all the criteria that are followed in the Human Microbiome Project for the healthy skin. And when I started, I thought we could extrapolate those kinds of criteria here. So as we know, in the face, the forehead and the cheek regions are not similar. The forehead is always more oily than your cheek. So we measured the sebum and hydration values from both the forehead and the cheek regions. And we did our sample collection very cautiously, because you need to collect the skin microbiome, skin swabs, and that may have some variability of the room. You have to do a room air microbiome also as a control. You have to keep all of the individuals in the same room. Whenever they came, we did not collect their microbiome. We actually kept them in the room for 3 to 4 hours. While the intrinsic microbiome comes back again. These are all the Human Microbiome Project skin criteria. And then we did the sequencing of the V3 to V5 regions. After that, we did our analysis. We did the analysis in-house, you know, bioinformatics. We have a bioinformatics in-house power, and there we do the, all these kinds of analysis. We found that we get more than 35,000 OTUs, even after removing the singletons. And these are the 34 phyla, and more than 900 genera were obtained, of which the 5 were the major or the core phyla, and 5 were the major or the core genera. And others were, you know, since you have a single DNA read in NGS, it's so sensitive, you will get to know all of them. But not all of them are very important, so you get the core. We did the Jacquard and the Bracartis indices. By the Jacquard index, you mean presence or absence of the bacteria. So as you can see, all the individuals except a particular sample here, except this particular sample, all the individuals are having same kinds of bacteria. When we added the abundance to it, the Bracartis index, it's the community structure, then you find all the bacteria, all the individuals, their bacterial abundances are not similar, except this particular individual maintains the heterogeneity, the homogeneity is very compact. So we went back to this individual's raw data, and we found that this individual has got cyanobacteria. Now, cyanobacteria in the skin is not very oftentimes you do find, it's very harmful also. So we thought that since it is healthy, do we go back to that individual and say that your skin may need some medical intervention? We were in two minds, but we found by when we interrogated that person did not abide by our criteria. She applied a herbal cream on her face for the last 14 days. She thought herbal cream is not anything that will do any harm. Now we know that cyanobacteria has a plant origin. So that's the reason why maybe this individual is showing surplus amount of cyanobacteria. So we immediately removed this individual from our analysis, but we were very happy to find out that our statistical analysis could understand the outlier, could identify the outlier. So now even if our sample size is reduced to 29, yet all our samples are very homogeneous. And this is very interesting. We found that with increasing cheek sebum, propionic bacterium increases, and bacteria like Haemophilus, Enhydrobacter, Valionella and Prevotella, they all decreases significantly. And with you know, increase in the hydration, just the opposite happens. Propionic bacterium significantly decreases with the increase in hydration, and all other bacteria that increased with the sebum, they actually decreased with the sebum, they actually increased with the hydration. We followed them up after 60 days. We followed them up after 1 year, because people can say that skin microbiome is transient. We found that most of them are constant. Even the sebum hydration levels are constant if you do collect them in a very cautious way. We found that with the European study, there was a European facial microbiome study, and all the DNA isolation kits, all the sequencers, they were same. But we found that our study has got abundance of proteobacteria and, you know, abundance of streptococcus. And their study, they have abundance of corynebacteria. Corynebacteria is considered to be fixing the ammonia in your skin, the sweat. They actually detoxifies the sweat. So they have in plenty. We don't have them in plenty. We have streptococcus that is considered to be harmful, to be in plenty. So we actually characterized the healthy skin microbiome. We published it in scientific reports. Then we went on to do shotgun sequencing and identified those species. And we find propionibacterium, acne, staphylococcus, epidermidis, and acinetobacter johnsoni. These are the three core species coming in all our samples. We are now doing studies on autoimmune skin diseases like psoriasis and atopic dermatitis. We are also doing a study on antibiotic resistance in chronic wounds, in chronic diabetic foot ulcers. These are the samples that we have collected. And we are funded by Unilever, DST, West Bengal, DBT, and DBT Central, and the Cygenome 2. That's our institute. Yeah, and that's our lab. And we will invite you to a human microbiome conference happening in NIBMG in November 2019. We are organizing it in collaboration with JCVI USA. And please do attend this conference. It will be, you know, there will be several European and American speakers. Professor Shoche is also going to come. And we are also inviting Dr. Ganguly, if he is. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Propionic bacterium is
free organic goinibacterium, streptococci, Rupes streptococci, and staphylococci. I don't know why you didn't find staphylococci.
We did find staphylococcus. Here we mentioned about only those that are not similar across the Western and the Indian skin.
Okay, thank you, Souvik. And we will look forward to your data from psoriasis and other skin diseases.
Thank you, sir.
So,